Hello, everyone. Thank you all for joining me. This is Radical History, where I deliver difficult truths about the past to a mostly receptive audience of a dozen on a good day. And we're all happy to be here. Actually, I'm really excited about this one. So, thank you all for showing up on such a short notice. I'm really excited to talk about John Brown. Today is the 161st anniversary of the raid on Harpers Ferry by, our boy, John Brown over here. You can see, wielding a Sharp's carbine in one hand and a Bible in the other, in front of the landscape of burning, bleeding Kansas. And we're going to talk about all sorts of cool stuff. So without further ado, I'm going to talk to you all about John Brown. So John Brown was born in Connecticut to Owen Brown, the hang on a second. There we go. To Owen Brown, who was a farmer, tanner, sometime preacher, strict Calvinist. For those of you who were not raised in the Calvinist tradition like I was, my father is a Presbyterian minister, so I'm keenly aware of this particular brand of American Protestantism. It's a number of things. It's a pretty severe, and as far as these things go, branch of American Protestantism, a very Puritan Protestant work ethic, and notably... is one of the Christian denominations that believes in predestination. You cannot get into heaven by works. You are either destined to be saved or not, which has a certain effect on a person's outlook towards the world, as you will find out. Anyway, so born in 1800, John Brown to Owen Brown. The family moved to Ohio fairly early on in John Brown's life. Seeking better fortunes. Ohio at the time was a territory, not a state, the Great Western Territory, I think, and John Brown had, by all accounts, a pretty, well, actually, he had a pretty terrible childhood, as far as these things go. His family was very poor, his father was domineering, his mother died in childbirth, but while he was there, the years he spent in Ohio were very formative. He befriended a lot of the native people of Ohio, or the Ohio area, what is now Ohio, and saw very early in his life a young black boy being beaten, a black boy about his age being beaten, and was, by all accounts, radicalized by this. This is one of the things that made John Brown who he is and who he was. This isn't really important to the John Brown story, but I think it's worth mentioning, because oftentimes when I talk about any number of things, you know, there's sort of like complications about a person's attitudes towards other people or areas in which they may not have been quite so, you know, quite so woke. But John Brown was, by all accounts, incredibly fair and kind to the indigenous people of the Western Territory, and later, after he was an adult, some white families where he lived asked him to help drive off Native Americans who hunted in the area, to which Brown responded, "I will have nothing to do with so mean an act. I would sooner take my gun and help drive you out of the country." He maintained peaceful relations with his American Indian neighbors and hunted with them, invited them to his home. So John Brown seemed to, for all of maybe his other faults, genuinely believe in some manner of racial equality and, you know, the actual, you know, equanimity between races. His father was an abolitionist and a participant in the Underground Railroad. And when John Brown set off on his own, he followed in his father's footsteps in more ways than one. These are the ruins of a tannery that John Brown opened in Pennsylvania. John Brown was not good at business. He started many and had many skills, and later in life became well known as sort of an expert in sheep herding and the quality of wool. But a lot of his business ventures failed, in no small part to the rapid boom-bust cycle of the early 19th century. All of the various bank crises hit him pretty hard. And his first wife died in childbirth, like his mother did. Eventually, though, he had 20 children, very few of which survived him. In any case, he was constantly on the move. He was known to have an incredible amount of energy. He started a lot of business ventures. He lived in a lot of different places, and but was never really very, like, wealthy or successful in business, outside of some specific context, which we'll get to later. So relatively early in John Brown's life, in 1831, there was an event that impacted him pretty significantly. A group of slaves in Virginia rose up and killed about 60 people. They were led by this man, Nat Turner. And though this rebellion was quickly suppressed, it sent sort of a shockwave through the nation. There was a belief among a lot of the slaveholding population, as well as the North, that slaves enjoyed their condition. They were happy to be enslaved. And so when Nat Turner rose up and violently killed a lot of slave owners and tried to rouse even more of his fellow slaves to warfare, this shocked the sensibilities of a lot of people who thought they knew better, and also terrified most of the white population, Northern and Southern. A lot of laws were passed preventing the education of slaves, and other laws were passed to make sure that this didn't happen again. And John Brown was inspired by Turner and impressed by him. Later on, he said that he held Turner first in esteem in his mind. And it is clear that this event sort of like planted a seed in John Brown's brain for what might come later. But don't worry, there's a lot of other things that are going to happen to make John Brown the kind of guy that he is. In 1837, a Presbyterian minister and abolitionist, Elijah Lovejoy, was shot and killed by a pro-slavery mob in Alton, Illinois, when they attacked a warehouse that held his press and abolitionist materials. He was well-liked and peaceful and otherwise, a popular person if you were not a slaveholder. And this was deeply radicalizing and upsetting to a lot of people, including John Brown. John Quincy Adams said of this that it was a shock of an earthquake throughout the country. And significantly, now, I believe that John Brown was always on this path, but he says shortly after this event, publicly, here before God, in the presence of these witnesses, from this time, I consecrate my life to the destruction of slavery. And it is pretty clear that from this point on, John Brown was doing exactly what he said he was going to do. Not too long after this, John Brown moves to Springfield, where he becomes involved, more involved with the Underground Railroad, pushing to make it even more effective and more radical. The Underground Railroad was largely, you know, a pacifist endeavor, but Brown wanted to make it militant. He wanted to arm both railroaders and fugitive slaves and fight back more seriously. During this time, he also became more involved with the merchant community of the North and East and made contacts with wealthy abolitionists and sort of the broader abolitionist community. This is when he met with Frederick Douglass, who after speaking at the Free Church in Springfield, spent a night speaking with Brown. And he wrote of this event, "From this night spent with John Brown in Springfield, Massachusetts, 1847, while I continued to write and speak against slavery, I became all the same less hopeful for its peaceful abolition. My utterances became more and more tinged by the color of this man's strong impressions." So John Brown had been a pacifist. His father was a pacifist, but he became increasingly convinced throughout his life, and by this point was utterly convinced that there was no resolution to the slavery question without violence, or at least some violence. During his time in Springfield, he sort of sowed the seeds for future financial support. And he was introduced to famous abolitionists, like I said, like Douglass, Sojourner Truth. And then he also founded a group called the League of Gileadites, which was created as a response to the Fugitive Slave Act to make sure that no fugitive slaves were ever taken from Springfield. And as far as I can tell, they never were. John Brown made sure that no slave catchers ever felt comfortable in Massachusetts or in that part of Massachusetts, and protected any on the Underground Road who came that way. So speaking of the Fugitive Slave Act, it's just worth mentioning this in passing, because it was passed in 1850, and it does exactly what it sounds like. It required that all escaped slaves upon capture be returned to their masters, and that officials and citizens of free states had to cooperate. You probably remember some of what I'm about to talk about from your middle school and high school history classes, so bear with me, but it's relevant. Also, you might not remember. I don't, but, you know, I do remember being taught about this. Just don't remember retaining any of it. This was one of many compromises that was put in place to, to make sure that the Union stayed together, that that there wasn't, for example, a civil war. But like all the other compromises, it ultimately just made people angrier, and it was also grossly abused. The slave catchers employed ruthless tactics, bloodhounds chasing down slaves across all the way to the border of Canada. And they also captured many free blacks on suspicion or just because they could. So this was a shitty law that sucked and was bad. And John Brown was angry about it. I'm angry about it. You should be angry about it, too. Another cool compromise that totally worked out perfectly and didn't cause anything bad to happen was the Missouri Compromise, which, if you'll recall, was a legislation that admitted Maine to the United States as a free state at the same time that it admitted Missouri as a slave state. And the idea was that as part of the compromise, there would be no slavery north of the 36th parallel, except for Missouri. This was signed by Monroe in 1820. However, by the mid-1850s, some folks had already gotten tired of that agreement. And the Kansas-Nebraska Act of 1854 created the territories of Kansas and Nebraska. It was ostensibly about all sorts of things, including like building a railroad, but what it really did was essentially repeal the Missouri Compromise. Yes. Look at all this. Sorry. Great point. Look at all this stolen land. Let me make this bigger. Oh yeah. Look at all that stolen land. So the compromise, the second compromise in the Kansas-Nebraska Act, was that new states or new territories becoming states would vote on whether or not to become a slave or a free state. Which, as it turned out, did not solve anything and was not a very good compromise. In fact, it just made things really bad because people from all over, regardless of whether or not they wanted to live in Kansas, went to Kansas to try to influence the outcome of this ultimate election. anti-slavery and pro-slavery forces, both militant, clashed, crossing over the border, killing people, intimidating folks, and otherwise just causing all kinds of a ruckus, which is why this period is kind of called, is often called Bleeding Kansas, and can be seen as a prologue or even sort of an extension of the Civil War itself. In 1855, a couple of Brown's adult sons, large adult sons, were living in Kansas, and he learned that they were not, in his opinion, up to the task of facing the pro-slavery forces. So, to protect his family and stop the advances of slavery supporters, he went to Kansas, enlisting one of his sons-in-law and son-in-law's sons-in-law. Is it like attorneys general? Son-in-laws. Anyway, and making several stops to collect funds and weapons to support this endeavor. Around this time, something else happens that pisses off John Brown and a lot of the abolitionists. In 1856, Senator Charles Sumner of Massachusetts gives a speech denouncing the crime against Kansas. And these Southern leaders who he regards as complicit, which includes, among other people, Senator Andrew Butler. And this is a great speech in its entirety, but some key points are, he says, "The senator from South Carolina has read many books of chivalry and believes himself a chivalrous knight with sentiments of honor and courage. Of course, he has chosen a mistress to whom he has made his vows and who, though ugly to others, is always lovely to him. Though polluted in the sight of the world, is chaste in his sight. I mean the harlot, slavery. For her, his tongue is always profuse in words. Let her be impeached in character or any proposition made to shut her out from the extension of her wantonness, and no extravagance of manner or hardihood of assertion is then too great for this senator." He also made some pointed criticisms that suggested in no uncertain terms that slaveholders maintained slavery so that they could rape their slaves. It was quite a thing to say about the genteel landowner yeoman's farmers of the South. Well, you know, we do have senators that eloquent. They just don't say anything of consequence. We have some very well-spoken senators. I don't care for any of them because they don't stand up and say, "You're an asshole," which is what the good Sumner said. I wish they would. That would be a good use of their eloquence. 2 days afterwards, after this speech, Representative Preston Brooks of South Carolina entered the Senate chamber, approached Sumner at his desk and said, "Mr. Sumner, I have read your speech twice over carefully. It is a libel on South Carolina and Mr. Butler, who is a relative of mine." And then he beat the shit out of Sumner with a cane, as you can see in this political cartoon. So, folks, if you think we're polarized now, whoo! No, but seriously, it was pretty fucked up. It sounds kind of silly, but it was a real heavy piece of wood, which he broke into several pieces, beating Sumner. Sumner had serious injuries. This was not like a light roughhousing. Great question. He did eventually, the whip, Karate Chop Whiskey, great question. The whip did eventually show up with the Master of Arms, but Brooks had already beat the shit out of Sumner and gone on his way. I don't know where he was, having lunch. Who knows? After this event, everybody was angry. The South sent hundreds of canes to Brooks's office, saying with messages like, "Do it again." And abolitionists all over the country were outraged on Sumner's behalf. Brown, among them, was absolutely fucking furious about the attack on Sumner. And this added to sort of his general level of pissedness. So, in May of 1856, pro-slavery settlers, led by the sheriff of Douglas County, Jay Jones, attacked and ransacked Lawrence, Kansas, which was an anti-slavery town, or was settled by anti-slavery settlers from Massachusetts who wanted to make Kansas a free state. As a response, John Brown and a band of abolitionist settlers, some of them who were members of the Pottawatomie Rifles, an abolitionist militia, killed five pro-slavery settlers north of Pottawatomie Creek in Franklin County, Kansas. So the story, the way that this story is often told is that John Brown and his band of abolitionists dragged these pro-slavery settlers out of their homes and beat and hacked them to death with swords, which is technically true. They did do that. But it's worth noting that they also left a lot of people alive. There were other men in the houses that they attacked, and after interrogating, they let them go. It seems, and again, I don't want to really like justify this because this is vigilante murder. Well, I don't know. I don't want to explicitly justify this. You know how I feel about people who support slavery. But in sort of like the grand scheme of things, if I'm trying to be, the view from nowhere, these are extrajudicial, brutal murders. But I want to make it clear that John Brown didn't just, you know, visit vigilante justice on whoever he could find. There was an intent to this. And it seems like the people that he attacked were members of pro-slavery militias or especially involved in the efforts. John Brown's role in this event was well known. And he was sought for justice and sort of a fugitive from here on out. But he was not caught, which in some ways led him to believe that he could get away with what was about to come next, which was a larger action. So this is John Brown in 1859, a daguerreotype of him, looking his most bearded and weathered and glorious. And so he returned to the East in 1856, where he started to lay the groundwork for his next big thing. He got the support, financial and otherwise, of many wealthy and powerful abolitionists, including William Lloyd Garrison, and several wealthy merchants known as the Secret Six, who provided most of the funding for his eventual raid on Harpers Ferry. In Boston, he met Henry David Thoreau and Ralph Waldo Emerson, who were supportive but broke and didn't have much to give him. In New York City, he was introduced to Hugh Forbes, an English mercenary who had fought with Giuseppe Garibaldi in Italy in 1848. And I'm going to have to talk about Garibaldi in a whole nother lecture because he keeps coming up and I've been meaning to. Brown hired Forbes as the drill master for his raid and to write the tactical handbook. This is also when he met Harriet Tubman. And as he began recruiting supporters for the attack on slaveholders, Brown was joined by Tubman, who he called her General Tubman. Her knowledge of support networks and resources in Pennsylvania and the states around it was invaluable to Brown and his planners. He chose for the eventual militant attack that he was planning, Harper's Ferry, because there was a federal armory there, a munitions plant nearby, and other strategic advantages like its location on certain rivers and close to the border with Maryland. The plan was to liberate slaves in the area and then set up a free state of armed insurrectionists in Appalachia. Some abolitionists, including Frederick Douglass and William Lloyd Garrison, did not approve of this and tried to discourage him, but he wanted to explicitly create a new state for freed slaves and was committed to military action by this point. He believed that after the first victory, slaves would rise up and carry out a rebellion across the South. Brown was inspired by and read very, very deeply about the Haitian Revolution and about the Maroon communities in Jamaica and in Central America, which I've talked about somewhat in other lectures, but he had a very clear vision of how this would work. And he had studied extensively how communities of freed slaves and escaped slaves had set up resistance in other in the Caribbean and in Central America. And this was his model. He was very, very clear-eyed about how this was supposed to work. And he had a very, very explicit plan about what the ultimate end goal was. He wanted to literally drain Virginia of slaves, create a militant force to oppose the South, and to, you know, sort of ruin them economically. It was a very, very, measured plan in terms of sort of like the long-term strategy. Unfortunately, the raid itself did not go quite as well as Brown intended. He had planned for up to thousands of men, but ultimately only had 21, 16 white, 5 black, 3 free blacks, 1 freed slave, and a fugitive slave. Many of them had been with Brown in Kansas, and he ultimately led 18 of them on the attack on Harpers Ferry, leading 3 behind. He had received 200 of the Breacher's Bibles, Sharp's rifles, and a number of pikes from abolitionist societies in preparation for the raid. I could not find out. I read somewhere that Harriet Tubman was supposed to be a part of this and didn't show. And I couldn't find out why. I didn't have time to dig into this, unfortunately. One source I read said that she may have been ill, but this is sort of like a big question mark for me, and I think for the history is Tubman trusted and liked John Brown, and John Brown relied on her, and it's not clear why she didn't show for this particular action. Ultimately, though, or initially, the raid went well. There was no resistance, just a single watchman. They cut the telegraph wires, captured the armory, and then they rounded up hostages from nearby farms, including Colonel Lewis Washington, great-grandnephew of George Washington. They also spread the news to local slaves that their liberation was at hand. Things started to go wrong when an eastbound Baltimore and Ohio train showed up. John Brown accosted the train, but let it go. And it's not clear why he did this, but the train eventually passed word that there were a bunch of armed abolitionists attacking Harper's Ferry. Though they were slow initially, the townspeople of Harper's Ferry eventually did rally and attacked the armory, pinning down the raiders in the armory by firing from high ground. Brown shot a couple people, including the mayor of Harper's Ferry. And at noon, a company of militia seized the bridge, blocking the only escape out of town. Brown moved the hostages and the few raiders that he had into an engine house, a small brick building at the armory's entrance, which you can see here in our image. Of his 19 men, only a handful, 3 or 4, were uninjured at this point. Hearing news of John Brown's attack, the United States military wasted no time at all sending a company of Marines. And on the morning of October 18th, the engine house was surrounded by a company of U.S. Marines under the command of First Lieutenant Israel Green, with none other than Colonel Robert E. Lee of the United States Army United States Army in overall command. One of the an army lieutenant opened or approached under a white flag and told that Brown that their lives would be spared if they surrendered. Brown refused, saying, "No, I prefer to die here." Stewart then gave a signal, and the Marines used sledgehammers and a battering ram to break down the door. Lieutenant Israel Green cornered Brown and struck him with a sword. The story goes that he tried to stab him with his saber after knocking Brown down, but his sword bent because Brown was carrying a badge or some sort of metal disc in his pocket, saving him from immediate execution. One of the hostages later said of this, Lewis Washington said that Brown was the coolest and firmest man he ever saw in defying danger and death. With one son dead by his side and another shot through, he felt the pulse of his dying son with one hand and held his rifle with the other and commanded his men with the utmost composure, encouraging them to be firm and to sell their lives as dearly as they could. Two of Brown's sons died here, and another would be hanged with him shortly thereafter, because they wasted no time in putting John Brown on trial. It was a very short affair. In a matter of days, he was found guilty of treason against the Commonwealth of Virginia, murder, and inciting a slave insurrection, and was sentenced to death. At his sentencing, he said, "Had I so interfered in on behalf of the rich, the powerful, the intelligent, the so-called great, or in behalf of any of their friends, either father, mother, brother, sister, wife, or children, or any of that class, and suffered and sacrificed what I have in this interference, it would have been all right, and every man in this court would have deemed it an act worthy of reward rather than punishment." John Brown was found guilty, like I said, and hanged on December 2nd. I want to show you, this is a very famous painting showing John Brown's last moments. The story goes that a slave woman held up her baby to be kissed by John Brown. This probably didn't happen for no other reason than John Brown was terrifying, and they probably had him very much in chains on the way to the gallows, but it's a nice painting and I like it anyway. He wrote on a scrap of paper and handed it to his jailer. He wrote a final statement on a scrap of paper and handed it to his jailer, which reads, "I, John Brown, am now quite certain that the crimes of this guilty land will never be purged away, but with blood. I had, as I now think, vainly flattered myself that without very much bloodshed, it might be done." This is sometimes called John Brown's prophecy, and Harper's Ferry is sometimes called the tragic prelude to the Civil War. At his hanging, John Brown was not allowed to speak. He was asked if he wanted to be given a signal when the gallows would drop, and he said it didn't much matter, just so long as he wasn't kept waiting very long. The execution was witnessed by John Wilkes Booth, Robert E. Lee, and Stonewall Jackson. And feel free to do with that information whatever you will. So, ultimately, John Brown's raid on Harper's Ferry was a catastrophic failure, right? It is unclear what went wrong, where his support failed to materialize. Part of it has to do with the time between when he had gotten so many people on board and received so much assistance and when he actually launched the raid. Other matters may have just been logistical errors. And John Brown was often portrayed, or was at the time portrayed, as something of a madman. You will recall our first image, right, with sort of like the crazy preacher look, and this was sort of the historical consensus at the time among abolitionists and among anti-slavery advocates. He was still considered a hero for a while, but one of the consequences of sort of the Great Realignment, the Blue-Gray Alliance, the Great Reconciliation, right, the lost cause narrative was sort of, you had to make John Brown into a madman. But the thing is that John Brown wasn't a madman. John Brown was incredibly clear-eyed, focused, absolutely, lucid. He knew exactly what he was doing, and he went about it with absolute certainty. He was an asshole by a lot of accounts, and possibly a fanatic, but he was not insane. Governor Wise of Virginia spoke to him in person after the raid and said, "They are themselves mistaken who take him to be a madman. He is a bundle of the best nerves I ever saw, cut and thrust and bleeding and in bonds. He is a man of clear head, courage, fortitude, and simple ingenuousness. He is cool, collected, and indomitable, and is but just, and it is but just to hear him say he was humane to his prisoners, and he inspired me with great trust in his integrity as a man of truth. He is a fanatic, vain and garrulous, but firm, truthful, and intelligent. So, the sort of consensus is that the John Brown's raid on Harper's Ferry was the precursor to the precursor, right? That it so inflamed passions around the country that by the time of the presidential election, there were four candidates. Democrats were split in two. Lincoln wins the vote with just 40, or wins the election with just 40% of the popular vote, and then the South secedes. And so, not only, you know, can we and should we think about the raid on Harper's Ferry as, you know, successful ultimately, and that John Brown was right, but he is a complicated man, right? It is this is terrorism, right? Like, I personally think that John Brown was utterly and ultimately correct in his decision making, and that though he sort of botched his ultimate action, that everything that he was trying to do was in one way or another justified. Harriet Tubman said of him that he was the only abolitionist that she saw believed that she thought believed that slavery was a life and death issue. Oh, Jay Biddy, he was a rallying cry. I don't know if you all know the song John Brown's Body, but it was a Union marching song. We sung it sometimes in school where I was growing up in Texas. It's a song about John Brown, and one of the words is, or one of the stanzas is, his truth goes marching on, or something like that. So he was, during the war for abolitionists and for the North, absolutely a rallying cry and absolutely a hero. It was not until after the war that he became complicated, right? That it became necessary to sort of muddy his legacy. But at the time, he was seen as a hero, and in many ways he was. And it is complicated, right? It's difficult to valorize political violence like this, but only because we have sort of crafted a narrative where this is not necessary. The truth is that if John Brown had done this a year later, right? If this had been part of the Civil War, he would have been a hero, right? All he did was get started too early. You know, he, it's just sort of like a matter of whether or not this was a government sanctioned action, which it wasn't. And ultimately I do think he should be remembered, differently than he is, or should be considered more important, because he was right. Everything he said was absolutely 100% correct. His entire life, again, he was kind of a dick. He was absolutely fanatic. He was bullheaded. But every single time he said, well, it looks like it's going to be violence, he was right. There you go. His truth is marching on. That's right. I remembered Lies a Moldering in the Grave. It's a good song. You should listen to it. I'm not sure that even if you believed that it was justified violence, and I do think that slavery justifies this level of violent action. You might not have taken the same, gone the same direction as John Brown, but you can't deny that he was right. Everything he said, everything he did, he was correct about. I'm sure he wouldn't have been happy to be right, but he could see that this country would not be made whole without bloodshed. And he got started a little early and he got caught out, but he deserves credit for that. And he deserves recognition for having what I believe is a truly admirable moral certitude. You don't necessarily have to agree with what he did. Innocent people were killed because of him. He possibly made things harder. I don't know. I'm trying to be fair. I think what he did was absolutely correct. But even if you think that it was wrong, he believed correctly in the grave moral sin of slavery, and concluded that the only rational response was armed insurrection. And I think he was correct about that. Ultimately, the country did not resolve its issues without violence. You know, even a century, yes, his family members did face retribution. One of his sons, I think four of his children survived. I don't know what happened to them. I know that one of his sons was hanged with him. Unfortunately, not very many of John Brown's sons or family members at all survived to adulthood. So the retribution was because of participation in the raid. I think the rest of them who were still alive and not directly involved managed to get away, but I actually don't know that for sure. And I don't know what happened to his descendants. Oh, that's not true. I actually heard an interview between John Brown. Is Ethan Hawke playing him on that Showtime series? I guess that would work. Ethan Hawke kind of has like the right bone structure, I guess. They better make him like real. They better put him in some like real weathered makeup, though. He was leathery at the end. John Brown was so. Ethan Hawke's too pretty, but yeah, that works for me. I think John Brown would probably be happy with that. Though, actually, this is funny. He probably wouldn't be happy with that. John Brown once bragged that he never learned to dance and had no. He would not allow anybody to speak of frivolous things at the church that he ran very briefly. He was a no fun type of dude, and he was proud of it. He did not like dancing or books or plays or anything. He was single-minded. So he probably wouldn't like movies in general, and he probably wouldn't like that Ethan Hawke is playing him, but that's okay. He's dead. Later, Malcolm X said that, you know, white people, of course, can't join the Organization of African American Unity, but if John Brown were still alive, we might accept him. So I think that John Brown is so interesting. I learned about him a little bit in school, and I get the impression that he's not like super important to most history curriculums. And I didn't really encouraged to think too hard about him, but I sort of like want to highlight that he was executed for treason, but Robert E. Lee was not. In fact, no Confederate generals were executed for treason. And I think that should tell you something about how we treat certain types of violence and what sorts of violence and what sorts of behavior fall within acceptable political discourse, right? Ultimately, it was more acceptable sort of to the political mainstream for the Civil War to happen and for the people responsible for it to be integrated back into society than it was for John Brown to try to free enslaved persons by force. And that's, to me, bad. But I also think it's instructive, right? I think it tells us what the political system allows for, right? What our political system finds objectionable and what it finds to be, you know, within the realm of acceptable discourse. For example, I don't want to draw too many parallels, but if you recall, you know, I felt like when it was happening that it was much more outrageous to the political establishment that people were, confronting Kristen Nielsen at dinner over, you know, family separation than they were about family separation, right? Like in this country right now, there are children and families in cages on the border or around the border. And if you bring that up, it is often seen as divisive. And if, God forbid, you confront a politician publicly about what they're doing, that's seen as out of order, right? That's seen as too political, like too polarizing, right? Ultimately it's about who's a person, right? And who is extended the full sort of accoutrements of being a citizen and a person within the political system. Karate Chop Whiskey asks if we have ever been more divided than right before the Civil War. I think that there's political measures of polarization. There are political scientists who measure this. I think that's a dumb and bad way to examine politics, but there are measures by which we are now as polarized as we were before the Civil War. Allow me to place my marker here and tell you that we're not going to have another Civil War. That doesn't mean there's not going to be more violence, but trust me, it is not going to divide us in half and we're going to do North versus South or East versus West or whatever. John Brown would 100% raid an ice camp. This isn't an endorsement and I don't want to say one thing or another, but I think it's interesting that there was an anarchist who attacked an ice camp in Seattle, William Van Sprouten, who cited John Brown as an inspiration. And he was killed trying to destroy the buses that were supposed to bring immigrants to the camp or away from the camp. So do with that what you will. So anyway, happy 161st anniversary to the raid on Harper's Ferry. Prayers up for John Brown. Pour one out for our fallen homies. Rough that it didn't succeed, but I think that it's absolutely worth remembering, worth talking about. Thank you all for being here while I talk about one of the people who I think is extremely interesting in American history and worth knowing more about. And I hope you all have a lovely evening. Stay healthy and stay safe. And I will see you all next time.